Hello and welcome back once again to the Parkinson's Disease Education Podcast. So great to be making another episode with you today. We're going to be talking about a very important enzyme that has some direct connections with Parkinson's disease. And that enzyme is called tyrosine hydroxylase. You may have absolutely no knowledge, foreknowledge or pre-knowledge of this, and that's why I want to share it with you because it's extremely important, as you'll come to see, in understanding not only what the role is in dopamine production, but also a potential role that tyrosine hydroxylase plays in disease progression, as well as in potentially completely changing the way we approach treatment of Parkinson's disease, potentially even reversing the disease. And that's what we're going to talk about on the other side of the intro. So buckle your seatbelts, stay with me for the ride, and we're going to have a really interesting episode today. See you on the other side. Welcome to the Parkinson's Disease Education Show, where we demystify the disease and empower you as the person with Parkinson's disease to reach your true potential. The content contained on this show is for informational purposes only and is not meant to be a replacement for information or advice that you receive from your in-person medical or therapy professionals. If you haven't already, I hope you'll consider subscribing, and for an even more personalized experience, please ask us about our memberships. Now, without further ado, let's start the show. So first, let's talk about tyrosine hydroxylase and what it does. Tyrosine hydroxylase is an enzyme, as I mentioned in the intro, and enzymes tend to help the body do various functions. So one of the primary and very important functions of tyrosine hydroxylase, among others, is it helps in the synthesis or the creation production of dopamine in the brain. The way that tyrosine hydroxylase works is it converts L-tyrosine to L-dopa. And being a hydroxylase, that implies that it adds a hydroxyl group or an OH to the molecule to form L-dopa. L-dopa is the direct precursor to dopamine. Chemically speaking, tyrosine hydroxylase is a catalyst. And as a catalyst, it's what's called a rate-limiting step in the production of dopamine. And it directly influences those dopamine levels. Now, as you know, with Parkinson's disease, there's a progressive loss of the neurons that produce dopamine, particularly the substantia nigra pars compacta. There are other dopamine-producing neurons in the brain, in the other basal ganglia, but the substantia nigra is the most numerous amount of neurons that are dopamine-producing that we have in the nervous system. On the surface, it might seem like if tyrosine hydroxylase helps to produce dopamine, that supplementing something like tyrosine hydroxylase or increasing it might actually help with Parkinson's disease treatment and management and even disease progression. But there's a catch to it. And it's kind of counterintuitive, but I want you to follow me along with this logic and see where I'm going with this. Actually, inhibition of tyrosine hydroxylase could actually be a key factor in fighting against Parkinson's disease, even potentially reversal of the disease process. And here's why. With Parkinson's disease, traditionally we have approached the disease process with dopamine supplementation or dopamine augmentation, if you will. So we're giving somebody products that basically help increase the levels of dopamine in the brain as the end result. Sounds like a good idea, but it doesn't really solve any problems. It really is just a band-aid on the issue of having decreased dopamine production. But you might be thinking, well, duh, you just have to give the brain more dopamine. What are you talking about, Dr. Michael? Well, here's the thing. Supplementing dopamine through L-DOPA and other medications actually results in more problems than it doesn't. For example, levodopa-induced dyskinesia is a large and very debilitating side effect that can come down the road from using levodopa for many years. One of the reasons that that happens is because dopamine replacement therapy leads to excessive dopamine fluctuations. That's because there are other areas of the brain that still do produce dopamine. Not only that, but L-DOPA or levodopa, when it's a medication form, actually literally changes the genetic makeup of the dopamine receptors. That results in the dyskinesia that we will find down the road. If you need a refresher on levodopa-induced dyskinesia, be sure to watch this video where I broke down some of the causes of levodopa-induced dyskinesia and why that's a problem. Here's the thing. If you have decreased dopamine production because those cells are dying off, but you have a need for dopamine, what do you think that is going to happen with the amount of tyrosine hydroxylase the brain is going to try to use to produce dopamine? It's going to increase. Increasing the level of tyrosine hydroxylase will still act on those neurons that produce dopamine and try to synthesize even more dopamine. That actually can result, though, in oxidative stress. Metabolism of dopamine directly results in oxidative stress, and when that's not managed, as you may remember from previous episodes where we talked about oxidative stress and its negative impact on the brain and other tissues, that can lead directly to cell damage, and that can result in cell death. Essentially, that part of the brain is a high traffic area, high demand. Production of dopamine takes a crap ton of energy, pardon my language, but it also takes a ton of chemical processes like tyrosine hydroxylase being that rate limiting step to producing dopamine, converting L-tyrosine to L-dopa and so forth. The reason I'm going into all this is because it's really a very important thing to understand in light of the conversation that I just had with Dr. Jonathan Sackner-Bernstein a few weeks ago. I'm going to be sharing some clips of our interview in this episode because I want you to hear exactly what Dr. Bernstein said and how he explained this in his own words in light of what we're talking about with tyrosine hydroxylase. Before I do share those clips, though, let me summarize just briefly how the dopamine-producing cells in the brain are actually partially dying because dopamine is building up in excessively high levels in those neurons. So as a review, whenever you have Parkinson's disease, there are multiple factors that result in those cells dying. The mitochondria tend to be sick and damaged in those cells. Some of those causes are genetic, some may be otherwise, like exposures. Regardless of why, those mitochondria, and those neurons are sick, and often those sick mitochondria lead to release of reactive oxygen species within the cytosol of that cell. That results in damage to that cell and could lead to cell death. In addition to that, alpha-synuclein, which is a normal protein found in single molecules, tends to aggregate due to other genetic changes that can be associated with Parkinson's within the cell. And alpha-synuclein aggregation tends to cause direct damage to that cell. Alpha-synuclein, very importantly, also results in the inhibition of release of dopamine to the receiving neuron on the other side, or basically the dopamine receptor on the other side. So neurons communicate with each other in what's known as synapses. That's where those neurons communicate with essentially a connection. You have a neuron, which is the body of the cell. You have an axon, which is essentially like an electrical wire that carries signals down, electrochemical signals in this case. And that axon ends in what's called a synapse or a synaptic bulb. You have multiple synaptic bulbs in each neuron, but for the purposes of this, we're just going to talk about a singular synaptic bulb. That synaptic bulb, let's say it sits here. On the other side, you have a receiving neuron, or a dopamine receptor in this case. And there's a small gap in between. That's called the synaptic cleft. Alpha-synuclein directly results in a problem of what's called vesicle formation, synaptic vesicle formation. At the synapse, small vesicles form with whatever neurotransmitter or other chemical that neuron is going to release to the receptor on the other side. In the case of a dopamine-producing neuron, it's dopamine that's being packaged up in these little synapses, or like little balls. They come to the edge of that synapse, or the synaptic bulb. It opens up into the space, and then that chemical transports over to the other side. So basically, the disease process with Parkinson's is not that the neurons themselves aren't producing enough dopamine, it's that they're producing dopamine that is not being released. So as dopamine is retained in those cells, it breaks down into its metabolites or its parts, and those parts are toxic to the cell. So that cell tends to end up dying. So you have, of course, a progressive dying of those cells that results in less dopamine production, but the lack of dopamine release from those cells is one of the primary things that's killing them. Dopamine production is a hallmark of Parkinson's disease, but release of dopamine from those cells is the primary impairment that's resulting in those cells dying, or one of the major primary impairments. So knowing that, you can imagine if you're still having tyrosine hydroxylase trying to synthesize dopamine in the brain, the neurons that are still working are being taxed a lot. They're being worked a lot, and that's increasing the amount of oxidative stress in those parts of the brain, and all the cascade of events that could happen leading to more damage, and basically the disease process ticks along. As you may recall from a conversation I had with Dr. Bernstein, they're working on a clinical trial, and they're about to start testing on human beings with Parkinson's this year, hopefully in 2025. The principle behind the drug, RB190, is that it reduces the amount of dopamine retained in those cells, and the cells that are still producing dopamine that are living in persons with Parkinson's. Well, the newsflash is that RB190 is a tyrosine hydroxylase inhibitor. The principle behind RB190 and tyrosine hydroxylase inhibition is that if you inhibit the activity of tyrosine hydroxylase, you inhibit the brain trying to produce more dopamine in cells that are retaining dopamine, and that's causing them to die. So if you selectively inhibit tyrosine hydroxylase, those certain areas of the brain could potentially allow those neurons to recover and for the disease process to slow down or even stop. Tyrosine hydroxylase inhibition can not only help with the improvement of motor symptoms like dyskinesia and other motor symptoms of Parkinson's, but also the non-motor symptoms, because excess dopamine actually results in some non-motor symptoms, particularly problems with impulse control, hallucinations, or cognitive decline. It's important to remember that dopamine, particularly, is important for three things: movement regulation, cognition, and mood regulation. And those three things are all impaired with Parkinson's because of the problem of lack of dopamine, or in this case, it's retention of dopamine in the cells that produce them. And if you have retention of dopamine in other areas of the brain, which we know is the case, as Dr. Bernstein highlighted in this clip.
So you need to know how much dopamine is inside the neurons. So before I started asking this question, guess how many people have ever reported the amount of dopamine inside the neurons?
I've never heard anybody talk about that.
Zero.
Yeah.
So I can give you tens, if not hundreds of citations where people talk about the importance of knowing how much dopamine there is in the cytosol inside the cell. Nobody's ever measured it. Nobody's ever calculated it. If you know the total amount, and then you know how many cells are lost, and people have counted the cells, and then you go to the axonal bulb, the presynaptic bulb, the axon, mm-hmm. and you know how many vesicles are there, because mm-hmm. they're reduced. You do it step by step, and you can compare what's in normal compared to what's in people who don't have normal dopamine metabolism, without Parkinson's, with Parkinson's.
Yep.
And what I found was that the caudate had about 87% higher amounts of dopamine inside the cells in people with Parkinson's than people without Parkinson's. And in the putamen, it was 360% higher. So that was astounding to me. Astounding.
That's a huge number.
Huge number. And it was evident whether people had been taking drugs or not.
Wow.
So
yeah.
It wasn't just because they were getting dopamine.
Now, you heard what he said. One of those areas had over 300% higher levels of dopamine than normal. So that's incredible. And so you can imagine in the areas of the brain that are particularly related to Parkinson's disease, that retention is also going to be high. So if we can reduce that level of retention of dopamine in those cells, we can not only improve motor dysfunction, but also non-motor non-motor symptoms of Parkinson's disease. So in short, and in summary, tyrosine hydroxylase inhibition could be and will likely be a game changer in how we manage and treat Parkinson's disease. Whereas when we're trying to augment dopamine, it really just puts a band-aid on the symptoms that dopamine loss causes. Whereas tyrosine hydroxylase inhibition is going to be a dopamine reduction therapy, meaning the cells that are retaining too much dopamine will be able to reduce the levels of dopamine stored in those cells and hence avoid cell damage and death because of that retention. That's going to help with management of dyskinesia. It's going to help with the management of oxidative stress and also non-motor symptoms associated with Parkinson's. It seems like a win-win-win. As a reminder, the specific drug that Dr. Bernstein is and his team are working on with the research is already an FDA-approved drug. It's not new, and it's entering phase 2A of the trials this year, very likely by the end of this year, in 2025, where we're sitting right now. Human beings will have tried this. Human beings with Parkinson's disease will have tried this in a trials, and we'll see where the results take us. Does that mean levodopa is going out the window? I don't think dopamine augmentation is going anywhere yet. But it gives me great hope to share with you the fact that there is a new approach that's coming on the horizon that could very well result in dopamine augmentation therapy becoming a thing of the past and helping the disease process at one of its root causes. I hope I filled you with a little hope and excitement today. For updates on the trial and other weekly updates and news, I would highly encourage you to go to parkinsondisease.blog. I'll put a link in the description down below. And that's something that you can use to follow Dr. Bernstein's work. And hopefully you can find out if they're looking for trial participants. Maybe you might be a candidate. I certainly will share information on that as it comes. Even if you're not able to subscribe to his blog, I would highly encourage you to keep following us on the channel here. Be sure to subscribe to find out updates on this and all topics related to Parkinson's that we can talk about here. Also, a final plug for our memberships. We do Ask Me Anything sessions at our one membership level. And on the next one, we do Parkinson's education classes. And I'd love to offer that to you. So please do consider that. It costs as little as a cup of coffee to join per month for our AMA membership. Thanks so much for watching. As always, be empowered. I'll catch you next time.